verlangen, dass ein unmöglicher Zustand auf dem Weg von friedlichen Revisionen bereinigt wird, um die friedlichen Revisionen konsequent zu verweigern.
After its defeat in the First World War, Germany was forbidden to have an air force, tanks, or submarines. A strict limit was imposed on the size of its army. When he came to power in 1933, Adolf Hitler swept aside these military restrictions. He also violated the territorial restrictions that had been imposed. In March 1936, he sent troops into that part of Germany west of the Rhine, which the League of Nations, created in 1919 to keep the peace and settle disputes, had decreed that no troops of any country should occupy. In March 1938, he engulfed Austria on the pretext of restoring order. Then he took a bite out of Czechoslovakia. The weakness of the League of Nations and uncertainty about what to do in the face of aggression led to the now infamous Act of Appeasement at Munich in September 1938. The British Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, returned from having signed that agreement, speaking of peace in our time. 6 months later, Hitler devoured the rest of Czechoslovakia. It was clear that the state of Poland, recreated after the 1914-18 conflict, would be Germany's next victim. Hitler was demanding the reunification of the port of Danzig with the Reich. In an attempt to save the Poles, Great Britain and France promised to come to their aid if they were attacked. On September 1, 1939, Hitler invaded Poland. On Sunday, September 3, Chamberlain spoke to the British people.
I am speaking to you from the cabinet room at 10 Downing Street. This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note stating that unless we heard from them by 11 o'clock, that they were prepared at once to withdraw their troops from Poland, a state of war would exist between us. I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently, this country is at war with Germany.
The British government anticipated an immediate blitzkrieg, even invasion. Within 8 minutes of Chamberlain's declaration, the air raid sirens began to wail, and it seemed that the worst had happened. But it was a false alarm. Britain carried on with its preparations.
Closing of places of entertainment. All cinemas, theatres, and other places of entertainment are to be closed immediately until further notice.
The evacuation of British children is going on smoothly and efficiently. The Ministry of Health says that great progress has been made with the first part of the government's arrangements. Railways, the road transport organisations, the local authorities and teachers, the voluntary workers, and not least, the householders in the reception areas are all playing their parts splendidly.
We're on number 12 platform at Waterloo Station, one of the 10 big metropolitan stations that are engaged today on the evacuation of London's school children. We're on number 12 platform, the train's in, and the children are just arriving, coming along in their school groups with a banner in front saying what school they are. This lot, St. John's School, Walworth, which is south of the river, and then they follow behind. The tiny tots in front, leading up to the bigger ones, the 12, 13-year-olds behind, and here comes a high school, more like 14, 15, and 16. They're being evacuated too.
A 1.5 million people, the vast majority of them children, were evacuated from the danger zones in London and the other big cities. For many, evacuation brought great unhappiness. By January 1940, 900,000 had gone home again. Some 14,000 children were sent to safety in America and the Dominions. Princess Elizabeth, aged 14, spoke to them, as well as to the children of Britain, when she made her first broadcast on Children's Hour.
Thousands of you in this country have had to leave your home and be separated from your fathers and mothers. My sister, Margaret Rose, and I feel so much for you, as we know from experience what it means to be away from those we love most of all. To you, living in new surroundings, we send a message of true sympathy, and at the same time, we would like to thank the kind people who have welcomed you to their homes in the country.
Evacuation overseas came to a tragic end when the liner City of Benares was torpedoed in September 1940. 73 children lost their lives. The British Expeditionary Force, which sailed for France in September 1939, expected to go straight into battle. Instead, it found itself kicking its heels in one of the worst winters on record. The 7 months of what became known as the Phoney War had begun. Richard Dimbleby, the BBC's first war correspondent who accompanied the BEF, was able to provide colour, but not much in the way of content.
We're standing in the pouring rain at the side of a French road. A road squelching with mud and lined right away over the plain to the far skyline with the inevitable double row of poplars. It's a grey, cold, dismal day. A few lorries only are splashing by to and from the forward areas. But coming down the road towards us is a battalion that I know to be of a famous Irish regiment. They're marching in threes, and in their full battle dress and kit, they blend with the dripping green grass of the roadside and the brown of the haystacks. As they passed us on that road, with their brown capes glistening and their tin hats perched on their heads, I thought how similar this must be to pictures of the last war. The road, the trees, the rain, and the everlasting beat of feet.
At home on Armistice Day, regularly observed since the end of the First World War, the Queen spoke to the women of the Empire.
War has at all times called for the fortitude of women. Even in other days, when it was an affair of the fighting forces only, wives and mothers at home suffered constant anxiety for their dear ones, and too often the misery of bereavement. Their lot was all the harder because they felt that they could do so little beyond heartening through their own courage and devotion the men at the front. Now this is all changed, for we, no less than men, have real and vital work to do.
The fear of gas attack led the government to issue some 40 million gas masks and to urge citizens to carry them everywhere.
What we're going on with this morning is the use of the respirator in a gas attack. Now, the first thing you would do is you'd hold your breath. The reason being, if you didn't hold your breath, you'd breathe in the poison gas and you'd be gassed.
Carrying gas masks was a habit that rapidly declined. It ended completely in 1942 when the government ceased its campaign, principally because of the need to save rubber. What action there was happening at sea. The passenger liner Athenia was torpedoed in the Irish Sea with the loss of 128 lives. The aircraft carrier Courageous was sunk by a U-boat in the Bristol Channel, and another put paid to the battleship Royal Oak at Scupper Flow. But the Royal Navy produced the first good news of the war when the German pocket battleship Graf Spee, which in 2 months had sunk 9 merchantmen in the South Atlantic, was so damaged that its captain scuttled her off the coast of Uruguay. Winston Churchill, as First Lord of the Admiralty, made the announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, the news which has come from Montevideo has been received with thankfulness in our island and with unconcealed satisfaction throughout the greater part of the world. The pocket battleship, Graf Spee, which has been for many weeks preying upon the trade of the South Atlantic, and met her doom. And throughout a vast expanse of water, the peaceful shipping of all nations may, for a spell at least, enjoy the freedom of the seas.
When the crews of the triumphant British warships marched through London, they received a hero's welcome. With the spring of 1940, the phony war ended abruptly.
It was about dawn this morning that the first reports came in saying that German troops were crossing the frontier into Denmark. At the same time, attacks were being delivered from the sea on a number of Norway's biggest ports. The Oslo radio is still working and has announced that German troops have disembarked at Egersund on the south coast of Norway and that Kristiansand has been attacked and also bombed.
Denmark was occupied in a single day. Norway, which saw the first offensive airborne operation of the war and the first amphibious landing, was taken, but not without heavy German losses at sea, inflicted by the Royal Navy. British and French troops came to Norway's aid, but after some initial success, were driven out. Over-optimistic reports in Britain had led the nation to expect a different outcome. Chamberlain no longer had popular support, and, as the American commentator Ed Murrow reported, he no longer had the confidence of Parliament.
This is London. I spent today in the House of Commons. The debate was opened by Herbert Morrison, one of the ablest members of the Labour Party. He doubted that the government was taking the war seriously. Mr. Morrison said that the Labour Party had decided to divide the House. In other words, call for a vote. Mr. Chamberlain, white with anger, intervened in the debate and accepted the challenge. In fact, he welcomed it. He fairly spat the words. He said that he had friends in the House, and he appealed to them to support him. When he had finished, Mr. David Lloyd George rose and placed his notes upon the dispatch box, and members surged into the room through both doors, as though the little square, gray-shouldered, white-haired Welshman were a magnet to draw them back to their seats. He swept the House with his arm and said, "If there is a man here who is satisfied with our production of planes, of guns, of tanks, or the training of troops, let him stand on his feet." No one stood.
Chamberlain had no option but to stand down.
"I sought an audience of the King this evening and tendered to him my resignation, which His Majesty has been pleased to accept. His Majesty has now entrusted to my friend and colleague, Mr. Winston Churchill, the task of forming a new administration on a national basis. And in this task, I have no doubt he will be successful."
On the very day that Churchill took office, the invasion of Holland, Belgium, and Luxembourg began.
"This is the BBC Home Service. Here is a short news bulletin. The German army invaded Holland and Belgium early this morning by land and by landings from parachutes. The armies of the Low Countries are resisting. An appeal for help has been made to the Allied governments, and Brussels says that Allied troops are moving to their support."
German paratroops seized vital Dutch bridges and airfields. The major Belgian fort of Eben-Emael fell to glider troops, and the Belgian army retreated. Allied Commander-in-Chief Gamelin ordered mobile units of the French army and the British Expeditionary Force to the Belgians' assistance. BBC correspondent Bernard Stubbs watched the BEF advance.
"Here, standing on the Franco-Belgian frontier, we're watching long columns of British troops and transports and supplies and guns coming through from France into Belgium. Just on this frontier, there's a little village which is presumably half French and half Belgian, since it stretches on both sides. And almost the entire village has turned out and seems to be standing in the street all day long watching these transports coming up. The welcome given by the Belgian people is really tremendous." But the enthusiasm of the people in this part of Belgium makes a sharp contrast with the sufferings of the refugees from such places as Liège. We saw several lorry loads of these unhappy people, and at one point on another road, we met a straggling little party of Belgians, old men and women and children, and some of them with rolled blankets tied over their shoulders,
their few pathetic belongings strapped on their back or carried in cheap suitcases in their hands.
For a time, as Charles Gardner reported, the Allies held up the German occupation north of Antwerp.
This roughly was the position when the British squadron was ordered to the attack. A French force was falling back to the lines of defence northeast of Antwerp, and they were engaged in a race with an advanced German motorised column which was rushing round to try and cut them off. It seemed possible that the Germans might manage it, and so the order went out, hold up that German column. The Germans have been bombing again today, mainly roads and aerodromes and refugees. And in one village, they hit a hospital, killing and injuring a number of people. Their latest trick, one which goes on top of bombing and shooting the ever-increasing stream of refugees, is to machine gun the cattle in the French fields, and lots of these have been seen lying about dead.
Then the panzers smashed through the Ardennes, considered certainly by the French commanders to be untankable, and across the Meuse River, supported by dive bombers. The static defences of the vaunted Maginot Line were rendered futile. The Germans drove deep into France. On May the 14th, the Netherlands gave in. Having disposed of the French Ninth Army by the following day, the German armour drove northwards towards the coast, cutting off the Allies' retreat. Churchill made his first broadcast as Prime Minister on May the 19th.
Having received His Majesty's commission, I have formed an administration of men and women of every party and of almost every point of view. We have differed and quarrelled in the past, but now one bond unites us all, to wage war until victory is won, and never to surrender ourselves to servitude and shame, whatever the cost and the agony may be.
There were fresh fears of invasion, fueled by the success of the Germans' airborne tactics. Sir Anthony Eden, Secretary of State for War, called for men to enroll in a new voluntary force, which was not yet called the Home Guard.
I want to speak to you tonight about the form of warfare which the Germans have been employing so extensively against Holland and Belgium, namely the dropping of troops by parachute behind the main defensive lines. Since the war began, the government have received countless inquiries from all over the kingdom, from men of all ages who are, for one reason or another, not at present engaged in military service, and who wish to do something for the defense of their country. Well, now is your opportunity. We want large numbers of such men in Great Britain who are British subjects between the ages of 17 and 65. 17 and 65. To come forward now and offer their service in order to make assurance doubly sure. The name of the new force, which is now to be raised, will be the Local Defence Volunteers.
Trapped in Belgium, the British and French armies appeared to be lost. Inexplicably, Hitler stayed his tank divisions, wheeling them south towards Paris, and relied instead on air attack. The decision provided a critical breathing space. A rearguard action was mounted, and a combined fleet of 300 warships and perhaps as many as 600 other craft of all types and sizes came to the rescue. Between May the 26th and June the 4th, 338,000 British, French, Dutch and Belgian troops were brought back from the beaches of Dunkirk. Almost all their equipment was left behind. Bernard Stubbs watched them come ashore in England.
For days and nights, ships of all kinds have plied to and fro across the channel under the fierce onslaught of the enemy's bombers, utterly regardless of the perils, to bring out as many as possible of the trapped BEF. There was every kind of ship that I saw coming in this morning, and every one of them was crammed full of tired, battle-stained and blood-stained British soldiers. Soon after dawn this morning, I watched two warships steaming in, one listing heavily to port under the enormous load of men she carried on her decks. In a few minutes, her tired commander had her alongside, and a gangway was thrown from her decks to the quay. Transport officers counted the men as they came ashore. No question of units, no question of regiments, no question even of nationality, for there were French and Belgian soldiers who had fought side by side with the British in the Battle of Flanders. All of them were tired. Some were completely exhausted. But the most amazing thing was that practically every man was reasonably cheerful, and most of them managed a smile. Even when a man was obviously on the verge of collapse from sheer fatigue, you could still tell by his eyes that his spirit was irrepressible. And that is a thing that all the bombs in Germany will never crush. On the station, I watched the men climbing into the long waiting trains. It was astounding to walk along carriage after carriage full of soldiers and to find in each one silence. For most of the men were fast asleep where they sat. In the dining cars they sat, most of them with their heads on the tables or on pillows improvised out of their equipment. Train after train puffed out of the station, all full of sleeping men. All the way along the line, the people of England stood at the level crossings and in the back gardens to wave to them. And so the men of the BEF came home.
Churchill described Dunkirk as a miracle of deliverance. The novelist J.B. Priestley spoke in his gruff Yorkshire voice in simpler terms and touched a chord in the nation's heart.
But here at Dunkirk is another English epic. And to my mind, what was most characteristically English about it? So typical of us, so absurd and yet so grand and gallant that you hardly know whether to laugh or to cry when you read about them, was the part played in the difficult and dangerous embarkation, not by the warships, magnificent though they were, but by the little pleasure steamers. We've known them and laughed at them, these fussy little steamers, all our lives. Sometimes they only went as far as the next seaside resort, but the boldest of them might manage a channel crossing to let everybody have a glimpse of Boulogne. They were usually paddle steamers, making a great deal more fuss with all their churning than they made speed. And they weren't proud, for they let you see their works going round. They liked to call themselves queens and belles. And even if they were new, there was always something old-fashioned, a Dickens touch, a mid-Victorian air about them. They seemed to belong to the same ridiculous holiday world as pierrots and piers, sandcastles, ham and egg teas, palmists, automatic machines, and crowded, sweating promenades. But they were called out of that world, and let it be noted, they were called out in good time and good order. Yes, these Brighton belles and Brighton queens left that innocent, foolish world of theirs to sail into the inferno, to defy bombs, shells, magnetic mines, torpedoes, machine gun fire, to rescue our soldiers. Some of them, alas, will never return. Among those paddle steamers that will never return was one that I knew well, for it was the pride of our ferry service to the Isle of Wight, none other than the good ship Gracie Fields. But now, look, this little steamer, like all her brave and battered sisters, is immortal. She'll go sailing proudly down the years in the epic of Dunkirk, and our great-grandchildren, when they learn how we began this war by snatching glory out of defeat and then swept on to victory, may also learn how the little holiday steamers made an excursion to hell and came back glorious.
After Priestley's broadcast, people stopped him in shops and bars and shook his hand in the street. Dunkirk was a victory, but only of the human spirit. To the watching world, Germany had effectively already won the war. Churchill thought otherwise. On the day after the French government sought an armistice, he growled defiance.
What General Vagon has called the Battle of France is over. The Battle of Britain is about to begin. Upon this battle depends the survival of Christian civilization. Upon it depends our own British life and the long continuity of our institutions and our empire. The whole fury and might of the enemy must very soon be turned on us. Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be freed, and the life of the world may move forward into broad, sunlit upland. But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States,
including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science. Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duty, and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its commonwealths last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
16 million people, half the adult population of Britain, became accustomed to listening to the BBC's 9 o'clock news. But on the occasions that Churchill spoke immediately after it, over 22 million people, 7 out of every 10 of his countrymen, hung on his every word. Through an act of will, Churchill lifted a nation from its despair and imbued it with the stubbornness to fight on. Denied Britain's expected capitulation, Hitler laid plans for a seaborne invasion known as Operation Sea Lion. First, however, the Luftwaffe had to pound RAF Fighter Command out of the sky. On July the 10th, 1940, the Battle of Britain began, with the Luftwaffe attacking Channel ports and shipping in an attempt to provoke a decisive engagement. The RAF, which had lost 900 planes in France, refused for the moment to be drawn. Charles Gardner, home from France, was at Dover with a recording car when a convoy in the Channel was attacked by German dive bombers supported by fighters, and an RAF squadron went up to engage them.
There are 1, 2, 3, oh, whoops, there's a dogfight going up there. There are 4, 5, 6 machines wheeling and turning round. Now, hark at the machine guns going. Hark. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now, there's something coming right down on the tail of another.
Here they go, they're going back.
Yes, they're being chased home, and how they're being chased home. There are 3 Spitfires chasing 3 Messerschmitts now. Oh, boy, look at them going, and look how the Messerschmitts... Hey, that is really grand. And there's a Spitfire just behind the first two. He'll get them. Oh, yes. Oh, boy, I've never seen anything so good as this. The RAF fighters have really got these boys taped. Our machine is catching up the Messerschmitt now. It's catching it up. It's got the legs of it, you know. Now, right in the sights. Now, go on, George. You've got him. No. The distance is a bit deceptive from here. You can't tell. But I think something definitely is going to happen to that first Messerschmitt.
Nothing like Gardner's eyewitness account had been heard on radio before, and it created public controversy. There were those who felt that a life-or-death struggle had been trivialized by what amounted to a sports commentary. Most people, fascinated by the immediacy, felt that this was the stuff of war. In August, Hitler issued orders to concentrate air attacks on RAF airfields. Fighter Command barely survived the onslaught. In the first half of the month, it lost over 200 fighters. By early September, the combat performance of its pilots was severely affected by fatigue. With his invasion fleet standing by, Hitler ordered attacks on civilian targets in the hope of forcing the RAF into sending up its remaining strength. On September the 7th, 300 German bombers, escorted by 600 fighters, raided London in daylight. During the next week, day and night attacks on the capital seemed to confirm that Fighter Command was on its last legs. Hitler set September the 17th as the date for Operation Sea Lion. But by concentrating on civilian targets, the Luftwaffe had taken the pressure off the airfields. More importantly, the respite had allowed the production centres to get on with their job uninterrupted. When the Luftwaffe launched another mass daylight raid on September the 15th, the RAF was able to inflict heavy punishment. This startling success was given in a bulletin by a newsreader who identified himself by name. All the newsreaders had begun to identify themselves since June, abandoning the BBC's tradition of anonymity. The BBC feared that in the event of invasion, the Germans might deliberately add to the chaos by imitating the broadcasters, as they had done in Poland.
Here is the midnight news, and this is Alvar Liddell reading it. Up to 10 o'clock, 175 German aircraft had been destroyed in today's raids over this country. Today was the most costly for the German Air Force for nearly a month. In daylight raids, between 350 and 400 enemy aircraft were launched in 2 attacks against London and Southeast England. About half of them were shot down.
Operation Sea Lion was postponed indefinitely. Churchill paid tribute to the men who had won the Battle of Britain.
Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
The Blitz continued in an attempt to destroy civilian morale. More than ever, the radio assumed an extraordinary importance in people's lives, not just for the news, but for the laughter which the comedy shows like Itmar, Bandwagon and Garrison Theatre provided. An unintentional comedian was the traitor William Joyce, who broadcast Nazi propaganda from Hamburg. His braying voice earned him the nickname Lord Haw-Haw. At the beginning of the war, as many as 6 million people tuned in to him. Some worried that he commanded a network of fifth columnists. Most found his claims ludicrous and regarded him as a kind of music hall act.
Germany calling, Germany calling, Germany calling. Here are the Reichs under ambush, station Bremen and station DXB on the 31-meter band. You are about to hear our news in English.
The British Ministry of Misinformation has been conducting a systematic campaign of frightening British women and girls about the danger of being injured by splinters from German bombs. The women have reacted to these suggestions and alarms by requesting their milliners to shape the spring and summer hats out of very thin tin plate, which is covered with silk, velvet, or other draping material.
As the war progressed, Lord Haw-Haw lost his audience. After it, he was hanged in Wandsworth Prison. The Luftwaffe switched to night bombing on London and other cities. Almost every night, up to 400 bombers attacked London. Many of the population took to the shelters, including the underground, where toilet facilities, canteens, libraries and entertainments were established. Robin Duff sampled life in a typical London air raid shelter.
It was a surface shelter that I went to, and it's one of the most cheering sights I've seen since the raid started. I've been round the streets most nights on one job or another, but I've never seen anything to equal this shelter for comfort and cheerfulness. All the people come from a nearby block of flats. There's a family atmosphere, and the place looks fine. There are flags on the walls and pictures of film stars, and the children have hung paper streamers all around. Along one side there are chairs and a few tables, and when I went in all the women were knitting very busily. There was a babble of talk and most of the children were playing cards. Everybody was laughing and joking, and if there was any noise from outside, they started singing. Their general motto seemed to be, take the notice.
Ed Murrow described London in the blackout.
This is Trafalgar Square. The noise that you hear at the moment is the sound of the air raid sirens. I'm standing here just on the steps of St. Martin's in the Fields. A searchlight just burst into action off in the distance, one single beam sweeping the sky above me now. People are walking along quite quietly. We're just at the entrance of an air raid shelter here, and I must move this cable over just a bit so people can walk in. I can see just straight away in front of me Lord Nelson on top of that big column. There's another searchlight just square behind Nelson's statue. I'll just let you listen to the traffic and the sound of the siren for a moment.
The Germans were now more systematically directing their attacks on strategic targets in the ports and the industrial cities. Life continued to be disrupted, people's homes damaged or reduced to rubble.
I spoke to a woman who lived next to a Baptist chapel that had been hit. She was buried under the wreckage of her completely demolished house. She was suffering badly from shock.
The first thing I knew was dust started to fall on me. The floor gave way, and I immediately realized what was happening. The roof came down. I covered my head with my hands and wondered, frankly, whether this was the end.
An interview by Audrey Russell. The bombing didn't seriously hamper industrial production, and the emergency services gave help to those who needed it.
Putting the DP and Trump to the death road on 22 stations ground.
Dispatch on file 28 station, reporting, sir. File, message from the fire in Badette Road. It is a building of five floors, about 150 by 100 feet, used as a general warehouse while alive.
You see, this order 36 is ladders to Commercial Street.
He wants a return voucher to Kimpton, is it? Kimpton in Hertfordshire.
Yes, exactly.
You just want to go down and see them settled and settle up matters, yes. And then you'll...
Any financial assistance you require. If you want any clothes, I'll help you with what you want. Are you fitted out all right with clothes?
Huh?
What sort of clothes do you require? Underwear and boots. Underwear and boots. Does that suit you? You've been bombed out and lost all your clothing where you are. Sir. This is your identification card.
A nice new pair of shoes she's managed to find. We were just short, weren't they?
Yes.
The Macintoshes are very nice. Come along, dear, because I wanted to finish up with Mother.
Hello, everybody. How are you getting on with your meals? Any complaints?
No.
We hope to do better when we've got more crockery and more helpers and a better stove. We hope you've enjoyed it all. What did you have today?
Roast beef, potatoes.
Roast mutton.
Mutton, lady, sorry. A carver night meat, Ritter. And plenty of vegetables.
And a pudding you've had, haven't you? Yes, or you're going to have a boiled pudding.
Yes, lady.
We hope you've enjoyed it. And what have you had?
I'm just waiting out, Mum.
You're waiting. Well, yes. I hope there'll be enough for you. We're doing our best.
Yes, there's plenty there for us.
We've got a rotten stove and we're hoping somebody would be kind enough to give us a better one.